Good morning and welcome to our Good Friday service. It's so good to see so many faces here in the chapel. And welcome to all of you who are watching in your homes here in the Villa Life Center. And a special welcome to those at the Lakeside Building who are watching live. We are live streaming this on YouTube for the Lakeside Building folks, and then later, more independent living residents can watch on YouTube and Facebook. So welcome to all of you to our Good Friday service. So we have gathered today on this Good Friday to be reminded again of the story of the final days of Jesus, the Last Supper, the betrayal by his disciples, Jesus' desperate prayers in the Garden of Gethsemane, his arrest, his interrogation, the mocking and brutal flogging, his crucifixion, and we also remember his resurrection. How important it is for us to hear these words again and these events and walk with Jesus through this story, this timeline of agony that he experienced on his last hours. One way to connect for us, to connect personally to the sufferings of Jesus in a spiritual and physical and emotional sense, is to share Holy Communion together. Today, we will do just that. As we receive the juice and the bread, we embrace Jesus' suffering and death. Everything in me wants to say, no, I don't want to embrace that. And yet, we say yes as we eat and we drink to the pattern of life that Jesus laid out for us as his followers. We will have a life that includes suffering, loss, and death. These things will happen in our lives, and we can surrender to this life of following Jesus as we drink the juice and take the bread, knowing that Jesus himself has experienced suffering and death, and that he walks with us in our own suffering and death. Furthermore, as we take communion together again today, we embrace the beauty and the power of the resurrection. Jesus conquered evil. Jesus conquered death. We are reminded again that our suffering now is not the end of the story. 1 Peter 5:10 says, "And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast." God will restore you and I and bring new life out of ashes and death. Before we begin our worship, a few logistics to go over as we prepare to take communion together. We are so blessed to have some wonderful volunteers that will help us distribute the communion elements to all of the residents who are living in the healthcare building and assisted living. So thank you to our volunteers who will help distribute these. First, the order of worship here, after I'm finished, we'll listen to a hymn and prepare our hearts and minds to receive communion. Then Chaplain Gary will bless the elements for us and have a prayer. And then the volunteers will be sent out into the building and you will receive your communion if you are in your home. It may take a good 30 to 45 minutes for you to receive the elements. If by the end, by 11 o'clock or so, if you haven't received communion yet, let a staff member know and we'll connect with you and make sure you get that. For those of us that are here in the chapel, Chaplain Gary and I will be serving communion to you. You might recognize these. These are our communion cups. Because of sanitary reasons, we've bought these instead of handing you a piece of bread and a little cup of juice. The juice up here is on the top, sealed by a peel-off lid. And the wafer, there's a tiny little wafer on the bottom of your cup. Do the wafer first. So flip the cup upside down and peel off the seal and take the wafer first. And then turn the cup over and take the juice. Peel the lid off the juice and take it. That will help reduce drips and spills. It may take, may feel a little strange for those of you who are in your home to take communion by yourself. It's meant to be shared in fellowship with others. We still have limited capacity here in the chapel. So as you take communion, I just suggest that you remind yourself that we are all taking communion together and give thanks for this community. I think we've covered everything, so let's shift our focus now to God's presence and our desire to worship. I would invite you, if you have a order of worship, to flip it over to the back, and I will lead us in a call to worship. I'll read the light print, and you are welcome to join me in reading the dark print, the bold print. As the sun gives way to darkness, the shadows of death are upon us. Today brings the last leg of Jesus' journey to the cross. Our Savior has broken the bread of life and poured the cup of salvation. His body will be broken and his life poured out. In solemn remembrance, we remember the saving death of our teacher, Lord, and friend. We linger in this dark hour, waiting for its story. We give thanks that death will not have the final word. Amen. Let's feel free to sing if you would like. We'll be listening to When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, and the lyrics will be up here on the screen.
When I survey the wondrous cross, on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches gained, I count but loss, and for content on all my pride. His hand to his
Good morning. It is wonderful to see you. This is the most number of people we have had in our chapel in 14 months. So thank you for being here, and we hope that this service is a blessing to you. We couldn't find it. Thanks, Mom. So, really and truly, I couldn't do my job without hers.
Can I just hold it for you?
Sure. This is a prayer of great thanksgiving.
Sorry.
The Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. It is right and good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join this unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to the church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the word. On the night he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks over it, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." And likewise, after the supper, he took the cup, and he lifted it up, and he said to them, "Take and drink, for this is the cup of a new covenant shed for you." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living creature in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. And now, gracious God, we ask that with the power of your Holy Spirit, you will bless these elements of bread and cup to the nourishment of our souls, that our faith be restored to you. Thank you. I invite the ushers to come forward now as we receive and distribute the elements.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let's join in prayer. I will end our prayer time with the Lord's Prayer, and I invite you to say it out loud with me using the words debts and debtors. God of all our days, on this day when the sun was darkened and the earth trembled, we remember your suffering. We see you as the one forgotten, the one oppressed, the one rejected. On this day, we hear your blood crying out from the ground. We hear also the blood of our sisters and brothers here in the U.S. and around the world who have suffered persecution, hate crimes, unjust prison sentences, and death. We feel you in the pain of the homeless poor, in the senselessness of starving populations, and in the wounds and death of armed conflict. We come penitent and sorrowful on this dark Friday, a day of murder and desertion. And we acknowledge that we are not innocent. We share in the evils of the world, for we have caused pain to others and to ourselves. We confess the need of your love that has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. You know what it is to be forsaken, and you understand pain. Have mercy on us, we pray. In the name of Jesus, who is one of us. And we join together in prayer as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Chaplain Gary has selected this passage from Mark 14, 12 through 31. His sermon is titled, Mind Your Manners. Mark 14, 12 through 31. On the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house," he enters, "the teacher asks, where is my guest room? And where may I eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." The disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at table eating, he said, "Truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." The disciples were saddened, and one by one they said to him, "Surely, you don't mean me." "It is one of the 12," Jesus replied, "one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." And then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "Truly I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. "You will all fall away," Jesus said, "for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter declared, "Even if all fall away, I will not, Lord." "Truly I tell you," Jesus answered, "today, yes, tonight, before the rooster crows twice, you yourself will disown me three times." But Peter insisted emphatically, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you." And all the others said the same. Let's listen to "Now Sacred Head, Now Wounded" by Fernando Ortega.
Thank you.
I can only guess that the Blessed Virgin Mary never told Jesus to avoid talking about religion and politics at the table. And we can see from this story that Jesus talked about religion in his own bare knuckles, no holds barred way. Now, the dinner party started out just fine. The table conversation turned grim very soon. The disciples of Jesus had gathered to celebrate the week-long festival of unleavened bread. And tucked into that week was Passover. Combined, the food and ritual prayers celebrated the movement of God's freedom amongst the Hebrew children held captive in Egypt. You might imagine Jesus taking the unleavened bread and the cup, offering this prayer, this Hebrew prayer. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, ruler of the world, creator of the fruit of the vine. Blessed are you, our God, sovereign of the universe, who has chosen us from among the peoples, exalting us by hallowing us with mitzvah. In your love, Adonai, our God, you have given us feasts of gladness and seasons of joy, this festival of Pesach, season of our freedom, a sacred occasion, a remembrance of the Exodus from Egypt. For you have chosen us of all people and consecrated us to your service, and given us the festival, the time of gladness and joy. Blessed are you, Adonai, who sanctifies Israel and the festivals. Amen. Into the midst of this long revered celebration of God's freedom, Jesus drops a huge family bomb. It is something like the favorite daughter, and I confess I have one, home from college on the Easter weekend, announcing at the Sunday dinner she is dropping out of college to join the circus in Sarasota. And by the way, the baby is due in September. Now, you can almost hear Grandma saying, "Well, that's nice, dear. Would someone please pass the peas?" And Jesus' announcement of betrayal is that one of his very own disciples will give him up to the Roman authorities. Like a lot of families everywhere, everybody wants to make nice at the dinner table and not engage in a family fight. Mark reports in an almost offhanded way Oh, yeah, they were saddened. And one by one they said to him, "Surely you don't mean me." Like many conversations around family tables, the fair-haired twins, avoidance and denial, manipulated the table talk away from the substantive issues that would challenge the fabric of family identity. The breaking of bread, drinking of wine, prayer, and the singing of hymns were typical elements of the Jewish Passover then and now. The disciples had grown up with these rituals, and like a lot of religious folks, they took for granted the words and the gestures of the liturgy. They did not see or hear the nuances of Jesus' actions, his coming death, and his radical commitment to the kingdom of God. They might have been more concerned about the texture of the unleavened bread or the bouquet of the wine. Some might even have been wondering about what is for dessert. Totally oblivious to the power of God's presence amongst them, not one disciple, get this now, not one disciple imagined that this would be the last time that they would dine with their teacher, their best friend, their brother. Well, after dinner, Jesus suggests that they go for a walk out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus states, "You will all fall away." Then he quotes a passage from Zechariah, "I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered." That's not the end of it. "But after I have risen, I will go ahead of you into Galilee." I would like to suggest that this story is perhaps the most important and essential story of all Holy Week, more important than the entire Gospels. Now, we're used to thinking that this is just the story of the Lord's Supper, or how the Eucharist was instituted in the Christian church, but it is not. This is the story of Jesus, the Jew, celebrating Passover with his disciples, the banquet of Jewish freedom. The upper room event is the question of discipleship and commitment to the way of the cross. Without the upper room, everything else falls apart. No cross, no empty tomb. And while our attention is focused on the doubtful commitment of the disciples, may I suggest that the dialogue is also about the depth of Jesus' commitment to the path he has chosen. Will he be bound to obedience and choose the path of radical self-denial? He would be less than human if we denied him this moment of questioning his willingness to follow his journey to Calvary. It is a doubt expressed later on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now see, we're too familiar with this story. We presume to know its outcome, but we deceive ourselves if we assume the conclusion about the fidelity of Jesus, the disciples, and our commitment to the cross. In my mind, that question remains to be answered. Let us not weaken the power of this decision by diminishing the decision makers both then and now. The real test of Jesus' commitment in the upper room is his relationship with Judas. It's pretty obvious from reading the text that Jesus understood the feeble faith of his disciples. He knew in advance they would fall away, and that And that has to include Judas. Jesus' first test of his commitment to the cross is his decision to dine with Judas, share a bowl of food with him, and then to wash his feet. Our brothers and sisters in the Tizay community put it this way: if he wanted to be faithful to the Father, to the God who chose Abraham and Israel, to the God of the prophets, Jesus could do nothing else but keep Judas close to him until the end. He loved Judas even as Judas was enshrouded in darkness. The light shines in the darkness, said John. That gospel says that Jesus was glorified at the moment he gave his love to who? Judas. And when he loved him, without gaining anything by it and beyond all measure, in the darkest night of resentment, even hatred, Jesus manifested the unbelievable radiance of God's love. In the words of Elie Wiesel, "I love Passover because for me it is a cry against indifference, a cry for compassion." I believe that to love anyone without gaining anything or beyond all measure is indicative of a freedom that the framers of the United States Constitution never imagined. As Bell Hooks has argued, love is the practice of freedom. In the case of the upper room, it would have been possible for Jesus to reject, exclude, or push Judas out of the room, but he does not. By embracing and serving Judas, Jesus is repudiating the violent domination and oppression represented by the Roman and religious leadership of his day. He refuses to be an instrument of the imperialism of politics or economics, the social power of the Roman Empire. By loving Judas, Jesus also offered Judas an opportunity to free himself from the power of the domination system of his day. Through love, Jesus showed Judas a pathway to freedom. The work of God's love remains the work of freedom, even today. We cannot talk about the love of God without addressing the powers and principalities that enslave people, oppress them, deny them the full spectrum of their human dignity and human rights. Love and justice are inextricably entwined. Reinhold Niebuhr wrote, "Love is the motive, but justice is the instrument." The love of God binds us ever more deeply to God's justice that promises, even to deceitful men like Judas, a place at the table and the embrace of freedom. When we are excused from the Passover table, we take with us Jesus' ministry of love and justice. We take up the service of human freedom as we enter into the Garden of Gethsemane, the courts of Pontius Pilate, and the executioner's domain. In every step of the way, we invite Judas, Caiaphas, Pilate, and the centurions to love and justice. We will go down to Georgia, and now apparently Texas, on election day, and hand out bottles of water for people who are standing in line for hours to vote. We will march up to the steps of the Capitol in Atlanta and Austin and every other state house and demand to every governor, "Let my people go." We will say no to hatred. prejudice, fear, and violence that stalks every minority community in this nation. We will grant them safe harbor, offer them shelter, food, and water. We will open our doors to gays, lesbians, and transgender people and keep them safe within our homes. We will sit them down to the dinner table, break the bread, and lift the cup as we pray, "Blessed are you, our God, sovereign of the universe, who has chosen us from among the people, exalting us by hallowing us with freedom. In your love, Adonai, our God, you have given us feasts of gladness, seasons of joy, the festival of freedom, the season of our freedom, a sacred occasion, a remembrance of the Exodus from Egypt. For you have chosen us from all people and consecrated us to your service and given us the festivals, a time, gladness, and joy." And may God bless you all as we continue the service of freedom. I invite you to now listen to "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior," a cappella hymn.
Save me by thy grace.
Now, dear friends, I invite you to go from this place in God's love and God's justice, so that we may arrive, each and every one of us, even old Judas, in God's freedom. Have a blessed Easter weekend. Amen.
Thank you.